Eastlake at USD. KUSD-TV, in cooperation with the Department of English, presents another in the continuing series of dialogues between Dr. John Milton, Director of Creative Writing, and American Authors of the West. Dr. Milton's guest, New Mexico novelist William Eastlake.
You see, there's no train there.
We're getting out in some good South Dakota sunshine now, and might be a little harder to think of New Mexico, except that a few minutes ago you were saying that it seems even brighter down there.
Yes, there's a glare.
More of a glare than here. I was just noticing in your list of publications that it's just about the time that you moved to New Mexico that you began publishing the short stories, the early ones.
Yeah.
Or was it just ahead of that time?
Just prior to that. New Mexico is where I hit my stride. As I said before, that was the country that appealed to me. What I had discovered.
But something before that had at least made you feel like being a writer.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. When I was a youngster, I thought I was going to be a writer. Mm-hmm. I called myself a writer, even when I wasn't writing. I think it is necessary, in my observation, that a writer be insane, that all the evidence in any career would point to the fact that no youngster should think of being a writer. There's very little chance of his being successful. In order to be a successful writer, it seems you do have to burn your bridges. You cannot go to school. You cannot have anything to fall back on. You must continue to the pursuit of this unsocial career that there's no allowance for in our society. So that is why I inferred that there must be a very strong neurosis in the personality of the youngster that will make him do this kind of thing.
Later on. Mm-hmm.
If he were a normal human being, certainly he would go into something else that society gave more rewards for.
Yes.
But there are no allowances for the writer. And you don't know at a young age what your abilities are, whether there is a touch of genius there. You don't know. We do know that your capacities are sufficient. Any normal person's capacities are sufficient. But whether there is that final creative thing that is very rare, we don't know until you've done a hell of a lot of work and had a lot of experience and a lot of failure.
Yes.
It's the only way of finding out. There doesn't seem to be any way that anyone can test it, whether it's just a flash in the pan talent that most youngsters have, or whether it's something truly creative, or whether again there is the discipline to continue on, which it takes a frighteningly large amount of, the self-discipline. This is what the unknown.
Yeah. Well, now you were about, if you don't mind my saying this, you were about 35 when you really started getting published.
33 in there, yeah.
Yeah, in the magazines. Yeah. Had you been working at the writing pretty hard up until that time, or?
Yes, and then a lot of time taken up in the Army.
Yeah.
And I had written several novels that were failures. One of them they wanted to publish after I was successful. And I decided against it. Mm-hmm. I didn't think it was good enough. The very valuable service that was performed for me by publishers was rejection slips. Mm-hmm. These were very helpful. It is amazing you can get an absolutely free criticism without charge by highly qualified people in the publishing world just by sending a manuscript in. And now, even if they glance at it and send it back, that's still something that's worth $1 million. Because that was their opinion. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. After glancing at it, after reading a few lines, they decided that it was not for them. And we can't keep insisting, idealistically, that the publishing world should do this, or should be different, or should give you anything. It's what exists. Mm-hmm. This is the reality. Mm-hmm. And this is the test. It doesn't make any difference what your friends or what a teacher says of your work. The important criticism is the free criticism that a publisher gives you by rejecting your manuscript. Mm-hmm. And this is invaluable. It was very helpful to mm-hmm. me.
Now, was this mostly from book publishers that you got the early rejections, or how did the magazine editors treat you?
Rather well. I never tried to publish in what they call the slick publications. I was trying to publish in the small journals. Mm-hmm. That's the kind of acceptance I wanted.
The literary quarterlies.
Exactly.
That kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Which you have an excellent one right here. Those are the kind of things that I had repudiated money as success. I was mm-hmm. that young. And I had known people who had been commercially successful writers, and I had nothing but contempt for them. That was, again, my sign mm-hmm. of being a young punk. I thought they had sold out all these cliches. I, of course, realize now they're honorable men who are doing the best they could.
Yes.
The very best they could. And they happened to find their niche in something that was very commercially mm-hmm. successful. Mm-hmm. And it was very arrogant and youthful of me to ignore them the way I did. I had one friend or acquaintance who finally ended up working for the movies at a very high salary. And I regret to this day that I didn't take advantage of this more, because mm-hmm. he happened to be a friend of Eugene O'Neill, oh. who more and more I'm intrigued with. And I think he was one of America's great geniuses. And I just regret that I didn't find out more from this guy about O'Neill. He was one of the very, very few confidants O'Neill had. O'Neill didn't have many. But O'Neill had illusions of making a great deal of money off the films. So, as a matter of fact, O'Neill wrote a few scripts that were burned, and by the Hollywood people. Mm-hmm. But O'Neill was interested in having a commercial successful film, which he never did. The films that this guy finally made were very bad. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it gets around again to the lack of opportunity that the writers are given in this country to participate in the film world, because there is nothing for a person who writes well in Hollywood at this time. There is no responsibility there, and no demand, no need for anyone of merit. Mm-hmm. This seems to be true with everyone I've discussed this with who has been there. It's very discouraging because there is a film renaissance going on in the world. I would guess that the greatest art experience in our time, the greatest contribution that's been made to the arts, has been in film. So this is a very exciting thing that American writers are not allowed to participate in, because corrupting all their
values.
Yeah,
doing something entirely different.
Yes.
Because I don't think there's any real relationship between the little magazines and the movies. Do you know of anybody who wrote or still writes for the literary quarterlies who has gone to Hollywood? I can't think of any offhand. Of course, now you've been involved in both to a certain extent. But by and large, the sort of writing that is published in the quarterlies does not reach Hollywood. Don't you think that's true?
Nothing of merit reaches Hollywood. If it does, then it becomes twisted and distorted to something that's quite corrupt. I am generalizing, but I don't think I'm being unfair. I would like to think of something now where they have done well. And the only thing I can think of offhand was a happy accident they had with Walter Vintelberg Clark's Oxbow Incident.
Mm-hmm. That was a very nice movie.
And which was very successful. Mm-hmm. They are frightened to death of the word art. They love the word money, which is very strange because they don't make any money out there. Their films are highly unsuccessful commercially, generally. And they seem to be getting their money from TV, from General Motors and Westinghouse. And they, General Motors and Westinghouse, pass on the merit of these films, along with Chase Manhattan Bank. So art is a word that frightens them very much. Mostly because they don't understand it, and the unknown is always frightening. And they have also, in fairness to them, to fairness to Hollywood, they have had some experience out there with arty people.
Yes.
So they tend to confuse artiness with art, and and if they do, they're justifiably off art. But they're particularly frightened of the foreign films, of Bergman's work, of Fellini's work, of the Japanese work. That frightens them because it may fill them with a kind of terror that they have wasted their lives in the pursuit of a psychoanalyst, which they generally end up with.
Yeah.
This is a very sad commentary on our time.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you think if one is writing toward the movies or toward the literary quarterlies, that this in some way determines the kind of writing that's done? What I'm thinking of specifically is that your Southwest novels, the first three books, are in a sense not quite anecdotal, but they're made up of series of pieces that can stand alone separately.
Yes.
Is this something that came out of the material or out of the fact that you were submitting to the quarterly magazines, or is there some other reason that sent you in that direction?
It came out of an unconscious discipline to tailor this creative work to something that was marketable, in the sense that the painters painted on a certain canvas, a certain framework, and it's no more of a compromise to paint on a certain size, number of pages, certain 20 pages is about what it came out, any more than it was for a Renaissance painter to paint on a certain size painting. There is no more problem, and you can unconsciously, it's got to be an unconscious act, tether a work to fit the marketplace. The important thing is that the marketplace be of value, that it be a market that will prevail, will survive.
But you seem to feel very comfortable now with these short units.
Yes.
Even Castle Keep is at least divided by the point of view and in reasonably short units.
That's true. I would guess that was an unconscious continuation mm-hmm. of the mm-hmm. system that I had used before. That is not true, however, of my latest novel. I don't know whether this is good or bad, but nevertheless...
The Vietnam novel, you mean?
Yes, mm-hmm. The Bamboo Bed. It mm-hmm. It doesn't follow this pattern.
Oh.
We just hope for the best in breaking this.
Well, the first book, Go in Beauty, this one is difficult to buy now. Out of print, I take it, and has not been done in paperback. How did that come about? Was that put together from any of the published short stories, or well, what was the conception for Go in Beauty?
It was started out as a series of short incidents that had taken place near my ranch, which is between the Apache and the Navajo reservations in northern New Mexico. And then I saw a novel in it using other material and was able to artistically successfully work out something that I was happy with. And that was the novel. I had been publishing Harper's Magazine, these incidents. They had asked me for a book, and so I did work up this novel with a central theme to carry it. And then, of course, I did the Bunk People, and then Portrait of an Artist with 26 mm-hmm. Horses. Then Castle Keep. And then the Bamboo Bed. One thing that critics that I trust have warned me about is that I should stay in the area that I know extremely well and feel, have roots in, when I write. But I find that this commentary is not valid in my case. Evidence seems to suggest it has been frequently true as a generalization, particularly William Faulkner. Seems to do poorly when he strays from York, Napapawthaw County. When he gets out of that immediate region in which he knows, and with the exception of his early World War I things like Soldier's Pay and...
I still haven't thought of the name of that story.
His novels are not successful. Pardon?
I say I still haven't thought of the name of that story, of Faulkner's. And yet your war experiences, of course, were personal. It's not... And Vietnam came out of personal experience again.
Yeah.
So aren't the critics just a little off base, saying that you're going far afield?
Well, I suppose they think that people who have started earlier and that kind of thing can handle it better. I don't know. I suspect that that war is a legitimate field for anyone who writes well. Certainly the great novels have come from wars, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. I was thinking of Tolstoy's War and Peace and Stephen Crane's Red Badge of Courage.
Yeah. Or even Hemingway. Some people like Farewell to Arms better than the others.
He certainly achieved greatness in his war books.
Yeah. There's a problem out here, too, of being stereotyped. Isn't this what a man who writes some books with a Western setting ultimately begins to worry about, is being cast as a Western writer because the people in the East would define that differently from the way we would?
Yes.
Is that part of it?
Yes, I think it's unconscious, but it must be there.
Mm-hmm.
Again, there's the value of the marketplace. If the marketplace tends to encourage a person who writes well in a certain direction. Now, this is not bad, as long as he continues to write well. It is unimportant whether he writes about New Mexico or Vietnam or Okinawa. Important thing is that he have an emotional link with his experiences and be able to write from that. What he writes about is not too important. How he writes is all important.
Yes. Now, do you remember back to, say, your early New Mexico experiences and then the materials and meanings that led up to Go in Beauty and Bronx People and so forth? What was it about the environment itself that did appeal to you emotionally?
Well, the spectacular beauty of the country, the exotics, the Indians, the Pueblos, the Navajos, the Apaches, the strangeness, the grandeur of space, the ranchers, the independence of the rancher, the greed of the rancher, the isolation. 10 years of splendid isolation, the time to be alone, truly alone, is very important, I think, to the creative person. It is a necessary ingredient of the artist to be alone. I think it is as simple as that. This is necessary.
Yeah. Now, you've been equally interested in the Indians and the whites in the area of New Mexico in which you live. In each of the books, the two have come together with almost equal attention, have they not?
Yes.
What among the, is it Navajo more than Pueblo in your immediate area?
Yes, it's primarily Navajo. This is a nation of over 100,000 people. And my concern has been pretty much uniquely with them, with the exception of a few short things like what nice hands held. My concern is with the Indians in my immediate area. And as I say, that's between the Navajo and the Apache reservation.
Yeah.
Being alone, of course, does not mean loneliness. I never had sense of loneliness there. For the first 6 months, it was a problem, but then you become part of the country and concerned with the country. I can see how people also write these cliche westerns. I was on about a 4-day cattle drive and had just come back to the ranch. I was helping a neighbor rancher drive these cattle up to the mountains. And when I got back to the house, there was a guy there from near a publishing house. And I was telling him about my experiences on this drive. And he said, that would make a good novel. We could certainly use that. Why don't you write that for us? So I did. Started it, and I was reading it back and to myself, and I thought, this is what a cheap Western is. This is when you use the thing as the cattle drive, all of those situations of which there's been an established pattern, even though the writing is done well, the structure and the form of the thing is such a cliche that it's sickening. However, It establishes the importance of always doing something, even if it's bad, rather than doing nothing. Because I did get an idea for the Wrong People from that horrible start. I could also possibly see a weaker person being seduced into writing this trash. The Saturday Evening Post made me a rather attractive offer once. Incidentally, if I do sell to a slick, as I do occasionally now, my only reaction to it is, I suppose the money is appreciated, I do have this fear that something is going wrong with my work. That what was it about that? What was bad about that story? So that it sold for a good price. This may be juvenile of me to equate good money with incompetence, but it's a pattern that a writer has seen consistently, and as a youngster has observed rather consistently, that those writers that make the money are a great corrupting force in our culture. They set up a value system that is very deceptive to the young, and in its final results, almost criminal. I can think of no greater immorality than to write badly. And this has something to do with censorship. There has been a long history of censorship in America, where such great works of art as D.H. Lawrence's work has been banned, and James Joyce for a while. While this criminal activity of writing badly was going on. And this is what corrupts the youth and the school. It's bad writing. It's not pornography that corrupts anyone. Pornography is simply a form of sexual behavior that is normal as eating, and that they should have erected this barrier is a very strange behavior that's very, very unique to the Christian culture. It's not true of the Navajos. They are rather a civilized people compared to the white American. You see that rather consistently, that in many, many ways their culture is far advanced over ours, particularly sexually. They have a much healthier attitude towards sex, and the cheapness and the innuendo of the bad novel would not go very far in the Navajo culture. They don't tend to see sex as anything dirty, as we do, as lascivious as we do. The Indian attitudes are very healthy, and an attitude that hopefully America's working towards. I do see encouraging signs that erotica is becoming more acceptable in our culture. There's still, again, the hope is
Blake at USD is another in the continuing series of dialogues between University of South Dakota Director of Creative Writing John Milton and outstanding American authors of the West. Dr. Milton's guest was novelist William Eastlake. This program was produced as a cooperative project by the Department of English, University of South Dakota, and KUSD-TV on the campus at Vermilion. Directed by Ernest Phelps. Produced by John Milton. This is a KUSD-TV videotape production, Gaylord Ayers speaking.